The people living in the Americas, you may recall, had come from this region called Beringia, which had existed for thousands of years, probably over 10,000 years during the last ice age. And they had been separated from their European and Asian cousins for at least about 11,000 years after the end of the ice age and rising sea levels cut them off from Asia. During this period, which we should remind ourselves was twice as long as all of recorded history, the population of Americans grew, as I said, to about 65 million. And of course, these people hadn't been idle. When they had arrived in the Americas, they found very few large animal species available to domesticate. So after a very long period when they lived as hunters and gatherers, while Europeans and Asians and Africans were also changing from being hunter-gatherers to domesticating cattle and horses and sheep and goats and pigs and chickens, the American cultures focused on domesticating plants and created three of the world's current top five staple crops. Staple crops produce the foods that provide the greatest percentage of calories that people eat every day. It might surprise you that today about 15 staple crops account for 90% of all the calories that people in the world eat every day. The top five are responsible for between two-thirds and three-quarters. And they also provide feed for animals whose meat we eat. They were all discovered or invented by ancient people between 6 or 7 and 10,000 years ago. And three of the five were discovered and invented in the Americas. The world's top five staple crops today, in order of importance, are maize or corn, rice, wheat, potatoes, and then finally cassava. Only rice and wheat were known to Europeans and Asians and Africans before contact with the Americas. The natives of what is now Mexico developed maize or corn from a native grass called teosinte, beginning about 9,000 years ago. Over generations, women, who were the farmers in ancient Mexico, selectively bred this grass to produce more seeds, bigger seed heads. Over time, maize actually lost its ability to self-seed and needs the intervention of people now to plant it. Maize is currently the most important staple in the world for both human and animal feed, as well as being used in a bunch of industrial processes like high fructose corn syrup, plastics, and ethanol fuel. Andean natives on the high plateau of what's now Bolivia and Peru created many varieties of potatoes beginning about 10,000 years ago. You can see varieties in village markets in Bolivia and Peru that no one has seen outside of those countries. Andean women developed these different varieties for different growing conditions and different needs. And because potatoes have a higher water content than grains, they also learned to freeze dry the potatoes for long-term storage. And finally, the people of the Amazon region not only discovered cassava trees growing in the rainforest, but they developed processes to turn these trees' semi-poisonous roots into manioc, what we know as tapioca, between 10,000 and 7,000 years ago, again. Raw cassava root has some cyanide-type compounds in it, so over long times, toxicity can build up. So in addition to domesticating the plant, Amazonian tree farmers had to develop technologies, combinations of boiling and drying and chemical leaching, to remove these cyanide compounds and to make manioc more useful. Along with rice and wheat developed in Eurasia, maize and potatoes and manioc are the most important staple crops in the modern world today, feeding billions of people. And we have ancient Americans to thank for that. Now, reliable, storable staple foods are a necessary precondition for long-term settlement and population growth. In other words, for the creation of cities, and then city-states, and then nations, and then empires. Like the Europeans and the Africans and the Asians, once they had created a reliable food supply, these American natives built remarkable cities, especially in Central and South America. Chichen Itza in the Yucatan was the focal point for the Mayan culture and religion. Tiwanaku, located near the eastern shore of Lake Titicaca in the Bolivian highlands, was built about 3,500 years ago. its 20,000 inhabitants, developed a farming technique called flooded raised field agriculture. And they covered the hills around the lake with walled terraces, which is remarkable because the lake level is 12,500 feet above sea level. And then the twin Triple Alliance capitals of Tenochtitlan and Texcoco in the Valley of Mexico each had more than 200,000 inhabitants when they were discovered by the Spanish. Tenochtitlan was built on an island in Lake Texcoco and was connected to the lakeshore by a series of causeways. The urban Aztecs at Tenochtitlan had a lot of people to feed. They farmed using what we might now call intensive gardening techniques. The Aztecs surrounded their island capital of Tenochtitlan with raised planting beds called chinampas that they recovered from the lake by building platforms and filling them with soil and fertilizer. This technique allowed the Aztec farmers to carefully control soil fertility, and of course watering was easy enough. The Aztecs supported 6 people per acre using these chinampas in the 15th century. Chinese intensive rice farming, which was the most successful agricultural technique then known in Europe or in Asia, only supported about 1 person per acre at the same time. So this was an incredibly efficient and effective way of growing food. To rival the Aztec chinampas surrounding Tenochtitlan, the Incas in South America built thousands of square miles of terraced farms in the Andes. As I said, surrounding Lake Titicaca in Bolivia were terraces rising from that lakeside elevation of 12,500 feet. And then dotting the eastern slopes of the Andes were cities like Machu Picchu, which was also surrounded by terraces. And these terraces were not only built and irrigated by hand at these extremely high altitudes, but guano, or bird manure, from coastal islands hundreds of miles away was carried on the Inca highways to fertilize these Andean farms. Many of these native cities have been hidden and their buildings and terraces torn apart by rainforest trees over the last 5 centuries. Some of them have only recently been rediscovered. Even Machu Picchu itself was only found by European Americans in 1911. Okay, now before we move on, a couple of questions for discussion. First, is it significant, do you think, that several of the pre-Columbian American cultures, the Maya, for example, were not at their peaks when the Europeans arrived? Secondly, how does the existence of a written language alter how we think of a culture's level of civilization? And then finally, why are so many of these Native American agricultural systems so impressive?